All right. Next, I'd like to welcome to stage, is Ashia Wilson here yet? Maybe she hasn't. Right, okay. Sarah? All right. We're gonna switch up the lineup. Oh, here. Oh, fantastic. Also. Okay, so we have Ashia Wilson. She is assistant professor of MIT, EECS, and LIDS, and she's gonna speak about generative AI and plurality. Great. Welcome.
So much. I got a little confused, apparently, stage, but I'm glad to be here. So I wanted to talk to you about how generative AI can enhance plurality and how it can be a threat to plurality. So this is joint work with some collaborators, my two students, Shamik Jain and Vinith Suryakumar, as well as my collaborator at Northeastern, Kathleen Creel. So we're living in an algorithmically driven world, increasingly so. Algorithms are being used to assist in allocating many, if not most, opportunities. They control who's represented, who is seen, and how they're represented in many circumstances, so our media. Who is centered during design processes is also up for debate in many communities. They're also deciding many resource allocations, so enrichment opportunities, educational opportunities, economic opportunities, such as credit and hiring, as well as even freedom opportunities, so access to pretrial release. These are very much well known. And so equality is a value that has been brought up a lot in discussions as we increase our algorithmically driven world with this new generative AI technology. Equality in allocations is a very appealing democratic ideal. Opportunities are considered foundational to freedom, and even our laws provide constraints on how opportunities can be allocated and how they are made. What is clear is that it's usually framed in terms of efficiency, so these allocations should be made based on features relevant to the goal of the allocation. And opportunities should be open to people without certain kinds of barriers, for example, certain kinds of features. So they have a long history of advocating for these kinds of equalities in our decision making. Bring in the moral philosophers. So a lot of people have tried to formalize, okay, how do we do this? And this is definitely what underlies a lot of what goes on in fairness in AI. So typically we think about a formal decision making space in which we can partition features into those that are meritous for the allocation and non-meritous. And we stipulate that the chances of success should be independent of features that are not merit. They should be totally based on merit. But as the philosophy community knows, there's a lot of scholars who have shed light on this formalism. First set of kind of criticisms is that, you know, there are various epistemic concerns with, you know, measurement and isolating merit from other nepotistic advantages. It also kind of forces us into a zero-sum thinking, whereby we narrow down our decision, our consideration space, and consider very narrow opportunity or allocations. Furthermore, there are a lot of thought experiments that have been introduced which shed light on the fact that having formal fairness is not necessarily all that's entailed in making sure we value equality. And so a lot of what a couple of scholars and I have been advocating is for a more pluralistic approach to thinking about how opportunities should be allocated. In particular, we've been leaning a lot on Joseph Fishkin's book, which is called Bottlenecks, A New Theory of Equal Opportunity, which advocates an approach whereby opportunities should be structured so that there are a plurality of pathways that result in a material good. So in particular, this approach would take into account the broad patterns and life chances for each individual and repeated encounters with decision-making systems. So let's get into a specific example. One algorithmic threat to this structural idea might be the idea might come across in hiring. So there's this idea that we're now living in an increasing algorithmically monocultured society. Take hiring, whereby how it normally goes is we have a litany of applicants that apply to each institution in turn. Maybe there's some centralized source. But now we're in a state of affairs in which many decision makers that collectively dominate a sector all rely on the same or similar algorithms. In fact, HireVue controls application screening for 60 of the top Fortune 100 companies. So we're getting this concentration whereby a candidate must go through one centralized decision maker to access an opportunity. So what we're concerned about is that the standardization is enforcing the same classification on the same applicant file each time it's encountered at scale. The same can be true for foundation models. Oftentimes, we are adapting the same foundation model for many tasks, which has the potential to create a single point of failure, or what we call a bottleneck in Joseph Fishkin's parlance. So what we want to understand, or what we seek to understand, is to what extent are opportunities made less plural because of foundation models, and generally speaking, our economic system of algorithmic decision making. Indeed, many of the components are shared when we develop these models as a matter of epistemic best practice. So as an example, we share a lot of models, data sets, libraries, and evaluations across many actors. And this could potentially create a standardization. What many scholars and I have been trying to understand is how much of this homogenization across these components results in a homogenization of outcomes for people. How much does this materially affect people and their opportunities in any given context? Furthermore, what kind of mechanisms, perhaps statistical, can be utilized to increase plurality without sacrificing potentially other values we might care about, such as validity or accuracy? So there have been a couple of recent works that I just want to highlight that have talked about how this comes to be in both foundation models as well as models that are deployed on wide swaths of the population. And what they're trying to measure are two things. First of all is systemic rejection. So the average probability individuals are rejected by all models, so what chances do you have for a uniform rejection, as well as systemic failure, how much or how likely you are to receive an accurate prediction across all models. I'll highlight, while they introduce a suite of experiments, I'll highlight one experiment. This is a prediction algorithm which is used in healthcare on a wide variety of individuals which see systemic failures for darker skin tones. In particular, for those who have darker complexions, these models tend to be inaccurate across many, many healthcare systems. And so there's this systemic level bias or inaccuracy that comes from sharing components across hospitals. I am actually now at time, so perfectly well timed. Just to close, algorithmic plurality is something that many increasingly are finding important, particularly as we begin to develop larger and larger models and all rely on the same kind of model for our downstream applications. Some remaining questions that we've been working on and are interested in are to what extent this concentration and standardization can be measured, particularly because we're living in a culture where we don't necessarily have access to all the components of the model. How do we actually achieve plurality without sacrificing on how well these models are performing? And how do we balance plurality with other values that we might care about? With that, I'll end. Thank you so much for your attention. Thank you.